So it's my pleasure to introduce Aditya Karnataki from Beijing Center of Mathematics, who will give a lecture on p-adic modular forms and completed cohomology.
Yes, thank you very much for the invitation. So since it has been a long day, I'm going to keep it a bit lightweight. But we are going to see some applications of the theory that we have been building over the last couple of days, which is like adic spaces, perfectoid spaces, and one wonders what is a good application. And I'm going to talk about Peter Scholze's paper on torsion class and cohomology of local spaces. And today we are basically going to just start introduction and talk about classical theory of p-adic modular forms, and then we'll talk about completed cohomology, which is for the past decade or so has been really a surrogate for the spaces of p-adic automorphic forms for different reductive groups other than GL2 or SL2. So historical comments, well, theory of p-adic families of modular forms is of course is at the center for quite some time. Yes. And for especially studying the arithmetic properties and congruences of modular forms and so on. And one of the key ingredients is a space of p-adic modular forms on which a certain p-adic Hecke algebra acts. So classically, you think about spaces of automorphic forms as some complex vector spaces, but then you realize that there is some arithmetic structure, and almost all the arithmetic structure has basically been captured by the Hecke algebra action on this space. And so for example, this space can be the Kartzer space of generalized p-adic modular functions, or you can have other analogs of it. Glenn Stevens has, for example, defined rigid analytic modular symbols, which generalizes the theory of modular symbols, which is an analog of classical modular forms, for example. And so the point is that we would like to define such spaces for arbitrary reductive groups and for p-adic local Langlands. There should be the word local here somewhere. Program and other such applications, because we want to study families of automorphic forms for groups other than SL2 or GL2. And for example, this is a hard question, except perhaps for groups that are compact at infinity, and Gross, I believe, has defined algebraic modular forms for such groups. But in general, it's very hard to define such spaces. And in a geometric situation where the underlying reductive group gives you Shimura varieties, you can define such spaces using some algebra-geometric methods. But their properties as like representations of the underlying group, or QP points of the underlying group, for example, are not clear. Like, you can define them as some sections of certain sheaves on these Shimura varieties, but how do they look like? And so, as I said, Emerton's completed cohomology serves as a suitable surrogate for a space of p-adic automorphic forms. So we are going to see how and why later in the talk. But this has the advantage of being definable for any reductive group. And it is defined as purely in representation theoretic ways. We can see how that happens later. And for groups that are compact at infinity, for example, it recovers the usual notion of a p-adic automorphic form. So it matches well with what you know. And it is cohomological. Its representation theory, it has many flavors. And we are going to see some of them today and in the last talk of this series. And its relationship with spaces defined in the Shimura variety context is a bit less clear before Scholze's paper. And the paper makes some fundamental progress in this direction. And one of the main theorems that we are going to see, maybe not this talk, in this talk, we'll see an outline of the main theorem statement, but the next talk, we'll see like a precise statement and see how to make that connection in this last slide. So we are going to give a brief outline of this theory. So the idea is that I will speak, I will give the first talk and the last talk, and in the middle talks, we'll define these perfectoid spaces, which help in relating these two concepts. So we're going to fix notation and recall some classical results for motivation. For those who don't know this, many of you know this much better than I do, but please bear with me. And so there is one remark that I want to make is that, you see, we said that Hecke algebras acting on modular forms gives you all the arithmetic information that is contained in the spaces of modular forms. And the point is, it is this action that is much more important than this form as a function itself. And so what we are going to call as systems of Hecke eigenvalues, we are frequently going to focus only on the eigenvalues and not think about the form as a function or as a vector, as an element in some space. And so this view is more suitable for the relationship with Galois representations, for example, which will come, which will be more clear in the next talk. And so it's the systems of Hecke eigenvalues attached to eigenforms that's the main object of this talk. So these are some historical comments. With those out of the way, let's remember that, you know, let's fix notation. K is the weight, N is the level, and we're defining the space of complex valued modular forms. So C is the coefficients, and we're going to change from C to, let's say, QP at some point later. But for now, let's just think about the complex valued modular forms, and the underlying level is gamma 1 of N, which is this modular subgroup, which is, you know, congruent to 1, 0, 1 star 0, 1 or whatever. And the first property that any most of us have seen in the properties in a modular form course is that every such f has a Fourier expansion at infinity, so to speak. And we're going to assume, you know, I'm going to be a bit sloppy somewhere. Wherever n needs to be bigger than 3, I'm going to assume that, for example, and so on. And so we have this Fourier expansion because whatever. And then we have the Hecke algebras acting on the space of modular forms. And they're defined very arithmetically for any prime that is away from the level. You can define the Hecke operators. There are two kinds of them. First is this diamond operator, so to speak, and the other is this TL that we have seen before. And these are endomorphisms of the space of modular forms. And so they are given by these two formula. SL is the diamond operator with L to the K minus 2, and TL we define directly on the Fourier coefficients, for example. And of course, the Hecke operators, even though we have defined them only on the Fourier expansions, you can define them in terms of Hecke correspondences on the underlying modular curves, for example. And they can also be interpreted in terms of double coset operators, something that most of us know already. And we're going to see both of them later on for more general reductive groups. And so we define the Hecke algebra away from N to be this Z subalgebra of these endomorphisms of the space of modular forms generated by the operators L, SL, and TL. So if you go back, SL had L to the K minus 2, for example, in its definition. And so for K equals to 1, you can get denominators. And so we don't want that, and so we're going to say LSL instead of SL, and TSL. So we call this the Hecke algebra, and some basic properties of Hecke operators can be summarized in this proposition. This is a commutative algebra, which you can see directly from the Fourier expansions, and later on you can see it from double coset operators, for example, or even Hecke correspondences. It's reduced, and it's free of finite rank over Z. This is only this is a Z subalgebra right now. We are not taking any p-adic coefficients or anything. And when you tensor it with C, this acts faithfully on the spaces of automorphic forms. And most of the properties that we learn in the first course on modular forms are summarized in that proposition, basically. And so then you have a certain commuting family of operators acting on the space of modular forms. So you have this concept of a Hecke eigenform. So F is a Hecke eigenform if it is a simultaneous eigenvector for all these varying Hecke operators for varying L away from N. And equivalently, you can define a ring homomorphism from the Hecke algebra to C, just sending each operator to its Hecke eigenvalue. Okay. And since I'm giving this on the generators, this is given on all of the ring. And this homomorphism is a system of eigenvalues because that's what it literally is. You take a Hecke operator, you send it to its Hecke eigenvalue, right? And so we are going to call this as a system of eigenvalues or an eigensystem, okay? And you need to think about it a bit, but it's a fact that any such lambda, any homomorphism from the Hecke algebra to C or to other fields, we're going to change C from C to QP bar or whatever, is the system of Hecke eigenvalues attached to some eigenform. And so we are going to stick to this lambda rather than the forms themselves in this talk and in the next one. And so if lambda is a Hecke eigen system, we write the lambda isotopic component to be the corresponding subspace of Hecke eigen forms which correspond to that particular eigenvalue. And so this is the remark that formalizes what I said just before. If lambda is an eigen system, the Q expansion and hence the eigenform is determined almost by the Hecke algebra. In particular, if the tame level is 1, then the lambda eigenspace is one dimensional. So it's uniquely determined up to a scalar. And in general, you will have the theory of old space, et cetera, but those are also finite dimensional and the structure is kind of well understood. And so this gives like a motivation for why stick to lambda rather than the forms. And now we are going to go towards the p-adic theory. So we are going to choose a prime p now. And everything was over z for now, but now we are going to choose p. And we are going to fix an embedding q bar into qp bar. And lambda is like a Hecke eigen system. Then you can view it as taking values in zp bar. So it is a theorem, for example, that the eigen systems, eigen values are algebraic integers. So you can really consider zp bar. Zp bar is the algebraic closure of zp inside qp bar. And so in the rest of this talk, we regard all eigen systems as being ZP bar valued. And you can reduce modulo the maximal ideal, that's pretty standard. We call the reduction lambda bar. And let sigma denote the finite set of primes dividing NP. Let Q sigma be the maximal extension of Q unramified out of sigma. This is usual notation again. And we denote the Galois group of this maximal unramified extension by GQ sigma. And for each prime L not in sigma, we have the Frobenius element at L, which is well-defined up to conjugacy. Okay. And the main theorem is that, main classical theorem, is that there is a continuous semi-simple Galois representation of this Galois group, which is unramified outside sigma, to GL2 of QP bar, attached to this lambda. So it is uniquely determined up to equivalence by the condition that for each prime L away from N and away from P, there's a 2x2 matrix, and up to semi-simplification, it's determined by its characteristic polynomial, and this is the so-called Hecke polynomial for prime L. Okay. The trace is given by lambda of TL, and the determinant is given by lambda of L, the diamond operator. And so the uniqueness assertion will follow, from Chebotarev density, because the Frobenius elements are dense and your representation is continuous. And Brauer-Nisbet, which basically says the semi-simplification is determined by that. And so what about the existence? If lambda comes from an Eisenstein series, like you have an Eisenstein eigenform, then the existence is easily proved. In fact, this is a sum of two characters in this case. And it is less trivial, or in fact, it is highly non-trivial to construct rho lambda in the case of an eigen system that comes from a cusp form and not an Eisenstein series. This was done by Eichler Shimura, names. And the point is that if the eigen system is attached to a cusp form, then the corresponding Galois representation is irreducible. And for example, you can see that this Galois representation is odd. And there is the reverse question of the Fontaine-Mazur conjecture, which we are not going to talk about today, but we can try to characterize representations that arise from a modular form or an eigen system. And for example, if there's an odd geometric blah, 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 then it comes from a modular form. We're not going to talk about that. And you can also reduce modulo the maximal ideal because it is possible to find an invariant lattice. And the lattice is not uniquely determined by the eigen system, but its reduction is. And so you can talk about representations over GL2 FP bar. And so the following more general result is true. If lambda 1 and lambda 2 are two eigen systems such that they match on all but finitely many primes L, or in fact a density 1 set of primes L, but anyway, then those two are actually equal. And this follows from the existence of Galois representation much more cleanly than anything else. And it's the same argument, basically, yeah, by Chebutarev density theorem. All right, and now we go towards the p-adic Hecke algebra. So for the prime p that we have chosen, we denote by tk p of n, the subalgebra of tk of n, which was the C algebra before, which we get by omitting the Hecke operators at p, for example. Okay. And for lambda and eigen system, we denote by lambda p, its restriction to this this Hecke algebra. It's a subalgebra. Lambda is a homomorphism, you just restrict it to it. And we refer to it as a p-deprived eigen system. And so by the previous remark about lambda 1 and lambda 2 being two things that match on almost everything else, then they just match. You in fact see that this lambda p will determine your lambda. Your p-deprived eigen system will actually tell you what the eigen system is. And so more concretely, lambda goes to lambda p is a bijection between the set of homomorphisms from these two algebras to Zp bar. It takes values in Zp bar. Yes. And so again, you can prove properties of eigenforms to prove this theorem that the ring Tp n has finite index in the big Hecke algebra. Okay. From here on, we are going to drop n from the notation whenever it is clear, and the coefficient ring also, because we're going to change the coefficient rings at some point. And now, we're going to consider this direct sum for each k. You're going to take direct sum from I equals to 1 to k of the spaces of modular forms, and you let the Hecke operator act in the obvious way by just each direct summon. And then we are going to make this following definition, the t weight less than or equal to k, to be the Z subalgebra of the endomorphism of these spaces generated by these operators again. Okay. But so this is like weight less than or equal to k. This is you take all the spaces from weights 1 to k, let's say, and you form these subalgebras. And so there is a natural injection into each copy, right? I mean, into a product of the Hecke algebras for each weight, right? And then you can again use similar arguments. Again, this is very classical that the image has finite index in this product. And even now, everything is over Z as of now. So, this, but slowly we'll go to Cp. And this is where we do that. And you have the obvious map given by a restriction of operators from a larger weight to smaller weight. Yes. And you tensor it with Zp, and then you will get a surjection of Zp algebras. And thus we can define, so you have surjections of certain Hecke algebras, you just let the weight go to infinity, for example. Right. And so you can take the inverse limit of these Zp algebras, which are weight less than or equal to k, and then just let k go to infinity. And you can take the limit of the corresponding SLs, they all match. And so you can consider these as elements of this Hecke algebra. This is called the p-adic Hecke algebra. And so for example, as before, there's an embedding of t into a countable product of rings, as before, where now you let k goes to infinity. And this again is a classical important result. The ring T is a p-adically complete and Noetherian Zp algebra, and it is in fact the product of finitely many complete Noetherian local Zp algebras. So instead of going from weight 1 to k, you are saying what happens. So the point is, when you go, you know, there's a mod p version of this also. And mod p, the weight is not properly defined, right? I mean, so there's a problem there. There's a technical problem that you can see. And so the remedy is that Sayre and Swinnerton Dyer, I think, found is that you consider all from 1 to k together, and then it makes sense. And so the point is, now it is only embedded a priori in an infinite product. And so this really has some content that it's in fact the product of only finitely many factors. And those two are Noetherian, like, so it's not really a big ring. And so that there are finitely many factors is an assertion about there being only finitely many FP bar valued eigensystems. Like mod P, you don't get many eigensystems. And this is the result of Joshnowitz in her thesis, I think. And each local factor being Noetherian, the only proof that I know is from Noetherianness of these pseudo-deformation rings. And there's no other way of proving it, I think, that I know. Okay. And so, for example, you see, T is embedded in this countable product of infinite product of these things, but it's only a product of finitely many Noetherian local things, which means that as k, you know, you take these finite k's, right, and you let it go to infinity. As k grows, the index of T inside that product is going to grow. And which really means that there exist many congruences, modulo powers of P, between eigensystems in various weights. And so this is a really non-trivial statement. And so in general, it tells you how structure theorems for Hecke algebras can give you information about congruences of modular forms. And so in general, it's very nice to know the structure theorems, anything about Hecke algebras. So this is the p-adic Hecke algebra, and we can talk about p-adic systems of Hecke eigenvalues, which, you know, are again a homomorphism of GP algebras from the p-adic Hecke algebra to GP bar. And if you have a p-deprived eigensystem as before from one of the finite parts, then you can just project from T, from T to TKP, and then just compose, and you will. So every p-deprived eigensystem will give you a p-adic system of eigenvalues, and these are, we call these as classical because they come from one of the finite parts. And the point is, even for these p-adic eigensystems, you can attach Galois representations. There exists a continuous semi-simple representation like that, where again, it is uniquely determined by its characteristic polynomial. So you see, eigensystems, Galois representations, eigensystems, Galois representations. That's the slogan. And the point is, you prove this by p-adic interpolation. So you know for p-deprived Hecke eigensystems, which are classical, you know the existence of Galois representations, and you show that this just extends to all p-adic eigensystems. So again, you need to work a bit. It's not trivial, but you can do it. And so this is one side remark. This is not needed today, but it's an interesting fact about completed cohomology that comes later on. So we have ignored the operators at P. And so if you look at the Hecke polynomial, its coefficients will not vary properly with as functions of the weight. And so I just wanted to stay out of trouble, so to speak. But if you consider Kartzer space of p-adic modular forms, then it has this additional Hecke operator UP, which corresponds to the matrix P001, I think. And so in general, you can define it again purely on the basis of Fourier coefficients, and you can just define this operator, right? And so you have T acting and you have UP acting. Well, but UP usually you don't throw in for T because all hell breaks loose. So this remark we'll come back to later because completed cohomology, which is our surrogate for Kartzer space, should also have some Hecke algebra action, and it should also do something at P. But in some sense, it's more robust at P. We'll see how, but later maybe. At least I think so. Maybe I'm not. Okay, so we have been talking about modular forms, but we want to go to cohomology at some point. And the point is that you have the classical Eichler-Shimura isomorphism, where you have two copies of, you know, of the space with of modular forms with complex coefficients. It injects into this cohomology group of this arithmetic, gamma is gamma 1 of n, by the way, sorry. Bad notation. And so this is an isomorphism, it should also have the isomorphism sign. But the point is that each eigensystem that appears on the left side will appear twice in this cohomology group. This, any homomorphism from here to C will, you know, like from the corresponding Hecke algebra will give you a homomorphism here. And so up to this issue of multiplicity, you can try to really understand the cohomology of modular curves if you just want to understand eigensystems themselves. And that is, for example, this algebra-geometric stuff that I said at the beginning. For Shimura varieties also, you have cohomologies, but automorphic forms is not clear what to say. Okay. And so when you go to a QP p-adic setting, the Eichler-Shimura morphism does not give you a priori a natural canonical map when you change coefficients from C to QP. Okay. So you will get two spaces which are, informally speaking, QP subspaces of the same C vector space, but they're not literally the same space. And the difference between them is typically given by some p-adic period, which is related to the special value of a p-adic zeta function or p-adic L function. And so this is usually highly transcendental in general. And so as Hecke modules, they're isomorphic in the sense that every Hecke eigensystem for one will, with multiplicity, will appear in the other. But they're not canonically over QP isomorphic. And so you need to really tensor with some p-adic period rings, which we have seen in other talks. I think BDR is the thing, but I'm not sure. But anyway, so, we'll see later that when we go to the completed cohomology setting, there will be an Eichler-Shimura-like statement later. All right. Okay, so we now need some notation, which is a bit heavy, but you know, you only see it once for this talk, and then I won't refer to it completely again. So now you want to work with arbitrary reductive linear algebraic groups, so let math BBG be that. And AG is the maximal Q-split torus in the center of G. And you take the real points, and you take the real points of the Q-split torus in the center. And K infinity is a chosen maximal compact subgroup at infinity. And then you have this definition, which is roughly the analog of a definition of the modular curve. But how that happens is a different story altogether. But you can see it in some explicit cases, of course. And so the space X, it won't figure too much in the later talks, so I'm not going to explain everything that's to be said about it. But you can really define a symmetric space for any arbitrary reductive linear algebraic group this way. And if you take G to be SL2, then you can work this out, what it means, and it will be some disjoint union of copies of modular curves. And so yeah, this is a disjoint union of smooth real manifolds of some dimension D. And so the point, maybe, do I make it here? No, all right. The point is that for the case of modular curves, this has an algebraic structure, basically. And this is not always true for other reductive groups. And so before that, we again need some more notation. This is the Adelic theory of modular forms. And again, of course, one has to set notation, so one has to give all the definitions, but we won't be really using the definitions, really, but we'll instead use facts about the spaces. So for KF, which is a compact open subgroup, which is like a finite level, it's the analog of gamma 1 of n, we define the open modular curve or the open locally symmetric space to be this double coset space. And you see, so why am I going there? You see, this part is the symmetric space that you already had. And so this is X, for example. And then some group theory basically shows you that this is the analog of an approximation theorem, And so you see that the coset representatives for the other part is like finite. And so this really is, can be written, this really can be written as a finite disjoint union of quotients of this symmetric space by some arithmetic subgroups, which are very explicitly given here.
Can I ask a question about the first thing? Because I skipped the pattern. The first one, so L0 is what's called the top degree, right?
Yeah.
And L0 is the bottom degree, right?
It's the bottom degree.
Is the sim supposed to be D?
So I think it's...
D is the real dimension of your microscope.
So it's symmetric about Q0 in for length D. Q0 is the middle degree, I think. Yeah. Maybe.
So that's not a standard notation.
No, no. I guess Q0
denotes the top.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah, this is so. You have Q0 is here, and I'm going to take symmetric around it rather than It's the middle degree. Yeah, sorry.
Oh, you're lucky, Raghuram has it right
here. Okay. Yeah. But this is, I think, the notation from the paper, so I'm just...
Q0 is always the top degree.
Really? Okay, we can sort it out later, but... Okay. Maybe I just made a typo or something. But I think I'm reasonably sure I want this.
L0 is like on the left, and you call Q0, whatever, is the average of L0.
Yeah. Okay. So... You know, we have been talking about abstract things, but there are some, you need some examples. And so for G is equal to SL2, as I said, you can choose the stabilizer of I to be your compact group at infinity, which is like SO2. And then you will see X is the upper half plane. And then the locally symmetric spaces are disjoint unions of, which I didn't write, but these are disjoint unions of the open modular curves in this case. And for G to be the quaternion algebra split at infinity, and you take, G to be the unit group of that, X is again the upper half plane, you can see that. But this time, when you quotient out by these gamma I's, you will get compact Riemann surfaces instead of. So modular curves, open modular curves are non-compact, as you have to put in cusps to compactify them. But Shimura curves, which correspond to the case of a quaternion algebra, they are compact already. And many times, people prefer working on Shimura curves for this reason. And the next example is a prototypical example that will keep appearing in this talk, where this is the veil restriction of some SL2, let's say, SL2 defined over an imaginary quadratic field, for example. And you restrict to Q. And then again, you can see that X is this quotient, SL2C mod SU2. And this can be identified with the three-dimensional hyperbolic space. It's a Kähler manifold. And the real dimension of this symmetric space in this case is 3, which is an odd dimension. And so it can never have a complex structure because any complex manifold or any Riemann surface, or not Riemann surface, complex manifold, has to have an even real dimension. And of course, this doesn't. So you will never have an algebraic curve or an algebraic variety corresponding to this case. But clearly, this is important that we understand such spaces also. And so you need to do something else. And so since these spaces may not carry any algebraic structure in general, we are going to talk about the singular cohomology or the Betti cohomology, which, you know, as topological spaces, they will always exist. And so this is I'm going to be a bit sloppy again here. Especially later in the next talk, we only need to worry about compactly supported cohomology. And then the existence of Borel cell compactifications tells you that the cohomology groups that appear at finite level, so to speak, are finitely generated as modules over the coefficients, indicate the ring of coefficients. And so this is something that is a side remark, and it just gives you good things about the cohomology groups, basically. And so we are going to fix a tame level, which is, you know, away from P. So it's like gamma 1 of N, but N is away from P, so to speak. And we denote it by some, you know, adelic points away from P of the group G. And for any, so, you know, this is away from P, what happens at P is the question. So you take G of QP, and you choose some level. And KP will, so tame level is going to be fixed in this talk later. But this KP will continue varying. And so if this is a compact open subgroup, then you may form Y of KF, which is like Y KP and away from P. And so we thus have a tower. You know, this is a conference or workshop about perfectoid spaces. You better have some towers. And so we have some towers at KP as KP varies. And again, this is a side remark, which is not so much of a side remark. It's a big theorem, perhaps. But all the Hecke eigensystems appearing in the cohomology of these open modular curves or open complex arithmetic manifolds with complex coefficients, they come from some automorphic forms on G. And this is a theorem by Franke in 1998. And for, of course, this is Matsushima's formula for GLN, and which is in turn a generalization of Eichler-Shimura. So the point is, the point of this remark, again, maybe I'm being very sloppy in some sense, but the point is that this is a good group if you want to understand Hecke eigensystems associated to automorphic forms. And so we need to understand something like this, but with C replaced by QP coefficients, because we're in the QP, you know, p-adic world, so to speak. And so with that in mind, we define these completed cohomology, and again, in the later talks, I will put a compactly supported here, but for now, you can just define it. And so for coefficients that are like C mod P to the N, so these are automorphic forms modulo P to the N. You can think of it that way. Okay. But you have a tower, and so, of course, this is cohomology, so you take a direct limit. So you keep the tame level fixed, and you vary the level at P. And so this would roughly, maybe I should go somewhere here. So you see your tame level is something like gamma 1 of N, then you have something like gamma 1 of NP, and then you have gamma 1 of NP squared, and so on. So we keep increasing powers of P, and keep N fixed. And the coefficients are z mod p to the ng, which is like modular forms, modulo p power n. And then, of course, I want to also go to characteristic zero from modulo p power n. So you just take a limit over n. So it's a projective limit of injective limit. So it's like a double limit. Yeah, you can put that. Yeah. But you can also consider this. And you can the difference between the two will be given by the BM cohomology, right? And so there are many, you know, you can really play with the exact sequences, and there's a lot to do there, but this talk may not be. Okay. And so this cohomology group, which is the we call this the completed cohomology. This is modulo P power N, and this is like the ZP valued completed cohomology. And this is a p-adically complete GP module. You can see that. All right. So as we have said, this is really the singular cohomology or the Petty cohomology. There is no, you know, this need not have any algebraic structure a priori. But I can just form the groups. Okay. And so we need to talk about Hecke correspondences or Hecke operators on this to talk about Hecke eigensystems, right? And so the best way to do this is through these correspondences, which I did not write for SL2. But you can really do this very canonically. So if you have two different compact open subgroups, and G is such that it conjugates one of them into the other, then you can define a finite morphism, I mean, because both of these are compact open, so it will be finite. So that's something that, which you just define it as a map of double cosets, and you check that it is well-defined and so on. And so in particular, I can take KF primed to be only the fixed vectors by G under conjugation of the original level. Okay. And then you get this Hecke correspondence. And of course, this can be defined for GL2, SL2 also. And you can really see that it's the same Hecke operator that you have seen before for choices of G that are different. And so for you get two maps. You get CG for each G like that. And you, of course, have C1 because identity. That's a trivial map, maybe. And so it really is maybe, okay. So what is my notation? So you have a correspondence is a diagram that looks like this, basically. And the point is, this is not an actual map, because this is a diagram of two maps. But the point is, any time you have a correspondence like that, it will give you an actual morphism on cohomology or other linear structures that are associated to your curves or associated to your geometric objects. So it's not a map of curves, but it will give you an actual morphism on cohomology. And this induces an endomorphism on the cohomology with whichever coefficients. The coefficients don't really matter. This is really a map, a correspondence on the underlying geometric objects. And you can further show that this endomorphism only depends on the double coset. And this is the double coset interpretation of the Hecke operators that you see classically. All right, so I have defined Hecke operators. I should define the Hecke algebras. And so we need to be away from bad primes, so to speak. So the bad primes in the previous case were N and P, right? Primes that were either P or that divided N, for example. And so the definition of being not bad is that this group is G of GL, which is basically G of GL. I mean, it's maximal hyperspatial, but. And now we are going to restrict to this case. Slowly we are going putting restrictions on things just for quality of exposition, so to speak. And so we are going to be in the situation where you restrict from some totally real, even now I'm not even putting any totally real or any hypothesis, but you're going to restrict from some number field to Q. And so S prime be the finite set of primes that, so you know, there's some bad things happening because you're restricting from a number field small, or it's not hyperspatial, which is the previous case. And then you take S to be, you know, just put P inside that if it's not already there. And so this is the bad set of primes. And so away from these primes, you can again form Hecke algebras. Right now it's allowed to be any finite extension of Q. And I will come to totally real slash CM case later. It means conjugate to G of ZL. Hyperspatial, or are you saying my maximal hyperspatial? I don't remember the definition, I'm sorry, like off the top of my head. It's, right. But, right, it's, yeah, it preserves that, exactly, sir, thank you. So you can find you can define double coset operators as before, and you can form this p-adic Hecke algebra. And I'm going to abuse notation slightly. I'm going to call T sub L. So this is the Hecke algebra of by G of ZL invariant compactly supported GP valued functions on G of QL. And under this convolution product, it is commutative. And then you have this for every prime L. And so for primes away from L, you can form this product, which is like the analog of the Hecke algebra that we had before. And of course, this acts on the spaces, and hence it acts on the cohomology as before. And Therefore, it acts on the completed cohomology. And we now restrict further to the case where F is either totally real or I have, should not have the word imaginary, it's CM field. All right, so before going further, this is the analog of what happens at P. And so earlier, you remember that UP acted on the space of p-adic modular forms, but that was only corresponding to this matrix P001. But now you have the action of the full group G of QP. And this is also one reason why you have to go to the completed cohomology.
Because there is not even UP unless you suppose that the level is in gamma at P. If you just consider
So if you restrict to gamma 1 of an intersection gamma 0 of P, that's what you mean.
You don't need to do this like in the beginning for your
right, yeah. So initially that there's not even UP, but it can come up, but only that comes up. That's right. And so this is the action which is given by the pullback of CG, where CG was defined earlier, right? I mean, this is just conjugation. And it is an action really on the directed system because it does not necessarily preserve your level, right? Level at P can change. But as long as you have all the levels together for KP, it really acts on the directed system and hence on the completed cohomology. And since in the on the underlying space, there is this Galois action, you have a Galois action on the completed cohomology as well. And so we have, I'm going to be a bit bold here because I couldn't find this exact statement written somewhere, but I believe that it should be true and at some level. And so take it this with a pinch of salt. But what happens if you try to understand something like Eichler-Shimura, right? I mean, you have now, for G is equal to SL2, you have two different objects. You have the completed cohomology and you have Kartzer space. And both of them are surrogates for each other, so to speak. And so they should agree at some level. And so let's keep tame level to be one, just for the piece of head. And then T was the p-adic algebra, which will be the same as TS that we have, for example. And acting on Kartzer space, which we denote by V. And then you localize at this maximal ideal, let's say corresponding to some representation. And if rho bar is in particular irreducible, and there's some other hypotheses, but I believe that, I should have an isomorphism there. There should be an isomorphism of modules over T Kasi, which has a commuting action of GQ and GL to QP. Where on the left-hand side, you have completed cohomology. Tame level is one, so I ignore that from the notation. And you localize at this maximal ideal. And rho U denotes the universal deformation of rho bar. And so this encodes the Galois action. On the left-hand side, there is a Galois action. And on the right-hand side, there should be something that encodes the Galois action. So this is rho u. And pi u is then a Banach module representation via p-adic local Langlands correspondence, which encodes the GL2 QP action on the completed cohomology. And there is the Kartz space for V. And so it has an action of UP in the appropriate case. And so you need to subtract that action, so to speak. And so let's say UP is equal to zero, you just put that into that. And that still has an action of the Hecke algebra, for example, away from P. So you put UP is equal to zero, and you add the action of GL to QP through this p-adic local Langlands. And there's the Galois action, which is the deformation of. And so I couldn't find this written in Emerton's local global compatibility, for example. Why UP is equal to zero? So this already encodes the GL2 QP action, the Banach space representation.
UP equals zero, it's going to be ordinary.
You mean to say I should put like a comma ordinary here or no?
No.
V is the space, space of Kartzer space. P-adic.
Just the union of p-adic forms?
Yeah. I mean, this is me going out on a limb to say this, but I believe that there should be something something like that in Emerton's paper. Yeah, so that is where this they don't have a similar statement in their paper, but I believe that it is something like this again, but I'm not comfortable enough to say out something like this is how it relates, but so I'm happy to be corrected by experts. Yeah, so this is not canonical, right? As of now, I don't claim that this is canonical. So I claim a similar statement that these are two QP subspaces, and it should become canonical after tensoring with BDR or something like that. Yeah. And I think there is a statement like that in the Iovita and their work, but maybe that is this statement after tensoring.
So what I vaguely remember when I was a student. This computing cohomology, there is this it's called a Jacques factor,
right,
that you can apply, and then you fall into the usual like Hilbert theory or Gauss theory.
Right.
Is there something on the right hand side that you can think of which kind of lose the chill to QP action, but still kind of QP action. Right? Because that's what the JK factor does, like it goes from G modules to T modules.
Right.
So you see like something natural on the right hand side?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know the answer. Yeah maybe. I see. Yeah. So the if you take the invariance by the unipotent radical of the Borel here.
On
pi. I see. Yeah. That would be the Jacques module functor. That's right. But then that's only solely over G, only on the pi, right? I mean, that has nothing to do with the Karsh modular form, so I don't know. Yeah.
That's why this UP is
weird. Yeah. Yeah,
so right. Why did you guess this UP was
here? In the sense that I was thinking about the fact that UP has a huge kernel. UP has a huge kernel, right? I mean, in general. On Carter space, and so I think if you ignore this part, then you have the local global compatibility, which is up to a finite eigenspaces. You get that's the form of local global compatibility that Emerton shows, for example. But anyway, we can maybe talk about it later, but. But anyway, this is I decided to put this just because I would learn something out of it. Anyway, so this is what we said before. And if you tensor with BDR, then this could be made canonical, perhaps. And so I'm going to rush through this because this is not important, but it doesn't matter. And so I have 5 more minutes, so perfectly in time. This is 55 minutes, right, I think. This was set for... Okay. So now we are coming to Galois representations and the connection with Peter Scholze's work. So recall that we are now in this case where you are restricting GLN from some imaginary from some totally real or CM field, and you can ask really about existence of Galois representations. But now you have a Hecke algebra. TS that you define, And so you can talk about eigensystems, taking values in ZP bar or QP bar. And the question is, can you attach a Galois representation, which is like GQ sigma is replaced by GFS for GLN instead of GL2. So N can be anything now, such that the eigensystems occur in this cohomology group which you have. And so the point is that if you restrict to ZP coefficients, the cohomology groups are known to contain p-power torsion classes. And so if you go to QP, then you know, they're going to be killed. But it is really important for number theoretical results that you take eigensystems that are p-power torsion here and still be able to attach a Galois representation to them. And so loosely speaking, again, this will be made precise later on, but one of Scholze's main results in the torsion paper is to construct a Galois representation valued in this Hecke algebra, which is the image of the abstract Hecke algebra acting on the mod p power n modular forms. And there are caveats here. In fact, this is not a correct statement, because instead of an actual representation, a Chenevier's determinant is constructed. And so what is a determinant? Well, I don't have time to define all that, but it behaves like the characteristic polynomial of a Galois representation. And so this is something, if you have seen pseudo representations, you keep track of the traces of representations, but in general, this is a much better version for technical purposes. So that's fine. The other problem is that this determinant is only constructed modulo I. So there is some nilpotent ideal of the Hecke algebra, which is conjectured to be zero, but it's not known yet. But it's nilpotent, and it's valued in T mod I. Yeah, but
it's a given number. When you say bounded, it's like depends on the group. Something there is some knowledge.
Yeah, but Newton and Thorne anyway have improved it to 4 now, independent of the group. So that is, I think, a preprint is out and a published thing is out. But for I is equal to 0, I haven't, I mean, it was announced, but I haven't seen it. Yeah, yeah. But the most general result is that under some assumption, it is proven that it is 0. Ah, I see. Yeah, I understand, yeah. Yeah, so I was going to mention Newton and Thorne, but So the nilpotent degree of I is bounded by 4, and under some assumption it is 0. But for the purposes of Galois representation, this doesn't matter, because a determinant will give you an honest Galois representation at a closed point, right? I mean, for a QP bar valued point or even an FP bar valued point. And closed points, again, of schemes are not affected by nilpotent ideals, because you only care about the reduced scheme structure. And so on his way to establishing this result, we have several other remarkable results. So let me motivate the next talks. Namely, we have been talking about perfectoid fields and perfectoid spaces. And so in particular, you can take these Shimura varieties that we saw today as double coset spaces. And you can consider towers of them, and they are in fact perfectoid. So this is a very striking application of the theory that we have been seeing for the past 2 days. And in particular, it is shown that in these cases where there is a Shimura variety, the completed cohomology is actually, you know, again, loosely, the cohomology of this perfectoid Shimura variety. And so there's a geometric explanation of the completed cohomology in this case. And in particular, this can become, we'll see this again next talk, but this can be computed by a check complex. And the point is, whenever you can compute something by a check complex, if the underlying dimension is D, for example, then the cohomology vanishes beyond the degree D, for example. And this is a corollary that Emerton's, under the definition, it's not clear that this inverse limit of the direct limit will vanish for some degrees. But once you have this geometric idea, you can really show that it vanishes in the expected data, with some minor caveats. I think Scholze has not strict inequalities, but something like that. Mostly done. And for the, so this is the statement. And so, and then again, there is the Hoche state p-adic period morphism, which we saw a glimpse of today in the talk on moduli of p-divisible groups, but it can be constructed in this Shimura varieties context. And its geometry, you know, it's a big door that has been opened in some sense. And so, so we'll see a construction of the Perfectoid Shimura varieties in the next few talks, and then finally come back to the application that we pointed out today, how to construct these Galois representations using this machinery. Okay, I will stop here. Thank you.